Professor Dave here, let's take a look at surface integrals.
He knows a lot about all kinds of stuff, Professor Dave explains.
Surface integrals can be thought of as a higher dimensional equivalent to line integrals. Instead of a curve C to integrate over, we will have a surface S. If we then have a function f of x, y, z, the surface integral of f over s will be expressed as this integral. While this expression looks fairly simple, just like constraining line integrals to the path of a curve, the complexity here comes from constraining to the surface S. And just like we parameterized curves for line integrals in terms of a new variable t, it proves useful to parameterize the surface S in terms of two new variables, which we will call u and v. The coordinates of the surface S can be expressed as a vector r equals x of uv, y of uv, z of uv. With this parameterization, we will be able to express the ds in the surface integral in terms we can use. It turns out that this ds can be expressed as the magnitude of the cross product of the r vector's derivatives, which we will call ru and rv, du dv. Written out, ru equals dx du, dy du, dz du, and similarly, rv equals dx dv, dy dv, dz dv. So our surface integral of f over the surface s becomes the double integral of f of r times the magnitude of ru cross rv du dv. The interpretation of these surface integrals is a bit more abstract, but if looking at the function f equals 1, then the integral gives back the surface area of s across the domain of the integration. For an example of how to set up the surface integral, consider the surface given by x equals u cosine v, y equals u sine v, and z equals v. In order to set up the integral, we must take the derivatives of these expressions. The vector ru will be given by the derivatives with respect to u, leaving us with cosine v, sine v, 0. Meanwhile, the vector rv will be given by the derivatives with respect to v, leaving us with negative u sine v, u cosine v, and 1. Now we must take the cross product given by ru cross rv. To find the cross product, we set up the matrix shown here and take the determinant. We end up getting sine v I minus cosine v j plus u cosine squared v plus u sine squared v k. And since cosine squared v plus sine squared v equals 1, we end up with the vector sine v negative cosine v u. Now we need the magnitude of this vector, which as we recall simply means the square root of the dot product with itself. This gives us root sine v squared plus negative cosine v squared plus u squared, which, given the same identity we just used, becomes root 1 plus u squared. This is the magnitude of the cross product, making ds equal to root 1 plus u squared du dv. So our surface integral of some function f over this surface will be the double integral of f times root 1 plus u squared du dv, where f is written in terms of u and v, and the bounds will be determined by the range of u and v. This example illustrates how to set up the most general cases of surface integrals. However, there is a simplified case where the surface we are integrating over is only a function of x and y, or in other words, z equals g of xy. For cases like this, x and y serve as our parametric variables, and our surface can be represented by the vector r equals x, y, z of xy. Let's find the expression for ds in this case. First, we find the vector rx by taking the x derivative, giving us 1, 0, dz, dx. Then we find ry by taking the y derivative, giving us 0, 1, dz, dy. Now taking the cross product rx cross ry, we take the determinant of this matrix. We end up getting negative dz dx I minus dz dy j plus k. Next, we need the magnitude of this cross product, which is the square root of dz dx squared plus dz dy squared plus 1. Now that we have this, we see that ds in this special case is root dz dx squared plus dz dy squared plus 1 dx dy. Putting everything together, our surface integral becomes the double integral of the function f times root dz dx squared plus dz dy squared plus 1 dx dy. Calculations for this scenario are much more simple and follow this easy-to-calculate expression. We only need to take care when dealing with complex bounds for x and y. Finally, just the way that line integrals could be used with vector fields, surface integrals can do the same. In order to express surface integrals with vector fields, we must first introduce the normal vector n. If we have a surface to integrate over, the normal vectors at each point are unit vectors that point in perpendicular fashion away from the surface. An easy way to visualize this would be to imagine running a flat piece of paper across the surface as a tangent plane. The direction straight out of the paper is the normal vector. Now, if we have a vector field F permeating space, the surface integral of F over the surface S will be F dot the normal vector n ds. This calculation ends up describing the amount of the vector field F that passes through the surface S, also called the flux of F across S. In order to go through calculations, we must know how to express the normal vector in terms we can use. For surfaces that are given by a parameterized r of uv vector, like we discussed earlier, the n vector ends up being equal to ru cross rv, divided by the magnitude of ru cross rv. So our surface integral becomes f dot ru cross rv, divided by the magnitude of that cross product, ds. But recall that ds equals the magnitude of the cross product times du dv. Plugging this in cancels the magnitudes out, leaving us with the double integral f dot ru cross rv du dv. This is the expression we can use to calculate the flux in any general case. But let's once again consider a surface where z is a function of x and y. We saw in this case that rx cross ry equals negative dz dx I minus dz dy j plus k. Recall how we can write vector fields in components p, q, r, so the dot product f dot rx cross ry ends up being negative p dz dx minus q dz dy plus r. And so in this case, our flux becomes the double integral of this expression, dx dy. For a complete example, consider the vector field f equals x squared xy z, and the surface given by z equals x plus y squared. Let's find the flux of the field through this surface over the range x from 0 to 1 and y from 0 to 1. Since the surface is given as a function of x and y, we can jump to expressing our surface integral as the double integral of negative p dz dx minus q dz dy plus r dx dy. Here, p is x squared, and dz dx is the x derivative of x plus y squared, which equals 1. Q is xy, and dz dy will be the y derivative of x plus y squared, so 2y. And r is z, which in terms of x and y is x plus y squared. Plugging all this in, we get the double integral of negative x squared minus 2xy squared plus x plus y squared dx dy, where both x and y range from 0 to 1. Evaluating the x integral first, we get the antiderivative negative x cubed over 3 minus x squared y squared plus x squared over 2 plus xy squared, where x runs from 0 to 1. Evaluating at x equals 1 gives negative 1/3 minus y squared plus 1/2 plus y squared, while evaluating at 0 will just give 0. The y squared terms cancel, leaving us with the integral from 0 to 1 of 1/6 dy. This gives us y over 6 evaluated from 0 to 1, which is just 1/6. This will be our flux through this surface. Surface integrals prove useful in many fields, such as when using Gauss's law in physics, which relates the amount of charge to the flux of an electric field through a closed surface. They are also used in some theorems, which we will be discussing next. So with that in mind, let's check comprehension. Thanks for watching, guys. Subscribe to my channel for more tutorials. Support me on Patreon so I can keep making content. And as always, feel free to email me, ProfessorDaveExplains@gmail.com.